Okay, thank you. Thank you, Michael. I will use the microphone as checking. Is it working?
Yes.
I will use the microphone, although I use my big voice at these kinds of events. By the way, anybody that's coming up here, be very careful about the wires. In fact, when I'm done, I think I'm going to rewire this behind a post. What a pleasure to be here, and I'm very happy to be a part of the entertainment with hopefully a charming opening a topic for everybody. We all hope one day that we become wealthy, and this is part of the formula. Which is the next button here? Okay, there we go. So, I was told to have a PowerPoint to keep you entertained, and it'll be easy, at least at the beginning. I'm just going to move this chair over. So this is what a patent looks like. That is the cover of the patent of the Wright Brothers invention, and that's an American patent. You draft the story that's inside. That's very important. You press the secret button. Which one is it? This one?
Spacebar.
There it goes. All right. Now, why do we want to get patents? Oh, sorry.
I'm going to just do one other thing here. And then I can put that out.
So I'm going to take, when should I be? 10:15?
You want to schedule
10:25.
10:25. Oh, excellent. Thank you. So,
since you're starting early, you might make that earlier.
I might make it earlier, that's true. All right, this is why we try to get patents, is we want to make money. And patents do help you make money. They help you make money. The money, of course, is useful because it gives nice things in life and it motivates you to do it. So people rush to the patent agent and patent attorney. And I'm here to tell the story from the viewpoint of a patent attorney of 35 years. I stopped going to the office about 7 years ago, but I started a new career. And in my new career, I made an oath to tell the truth. So I'm a new man, and part of the story is that it isn't at all a happy story of getting rich easily. So there's some bad news, and a patent itself doesn't provide you with the win. You've got to have a working invention. And if you have a working invention, then the patent will increase profitability, but the patent does not make it succeed. So they allow you to charge people more. That's the whole essence of the system. And why can you charge more? Because you are the only one in the market and there's no competition. So the purpose of the patent is to remove competition. But the product itself has to be something people want to buy. So here's what patenting can't achieve. You can't exclude competitors from selling anything that was previously available. Now, in the field of LENR, we've had, since 1989, thousands of articles that have been published. Anything that's described properly in those articles can no longer be patented. And you have to live with them. If you came up with a wonderful way of doing an LENR reaction, you have to live with the fact that somebody could say, oh, I found this paper back in 2009, I'm going to use this one. They're totally immune. Patents do not affect anything that was previously available. And the second thing here is that patents cannot prevent people from thinking of a new way of doing it. So if you invent a gasoline engine that runs on gasoline, you can't stop Mr. Diesel from coming in with his diesel engine because the diesel engine's a different principle. A patent can only exclude people to the extent of what you wrote in your patent application, and you write the definition of what your exclusive rights are. You're responsible for writing that. And part of my message to everybody here is, if you ever do get yourself in a patenting situation, do not just turn it over to your attorney. Try and understand the process and participate in it. So, Your claims, when you write them, are fraught with difficulties. And they may be inadequately drafted, and unfortunately, your attorney will try and do a good job, but he won't tell you if he's gone and done a bad job. So you want to approach your attorney, and I suggest if you're a courageous person, that's your reaction when you find out that the patent you paid for isn't as effective as you thought. So you want to go to your attorney, and here's an interesting way to start a conversation. He may not like it. Am I going to get value for the money that I am paying to you? Well, you'll get a lot of that's not for me to say. Now, I'm going to stop the slides just for a minute and just talk about what an attorney could be saying to you if he wanted to tell you the truth. Your invention is trash. It doesn't work, it's not cost effective, and no one will buy it because it has no appeal. I don't think there's very many attorneys that would say it, not in those brutal words. A few of them might say, are you sure people are going to want to buy your new wagon for children? And if you say, oh, yes, because you're swept up in the inebriation of your invention, then your attorney will take your money, but you're not going to get anything of value. Now, the attorney may also look at your wagon and say to himself, you know, there are other wagons already on the market. And although you may have an invention and you may get a patent because there's something new about what you've done, if there are other alternatives on the market, you're not going to be a success in the market. Often you can't get good patent protection because of that prior art. People have done this before, people have done that before, and you're limited with what you can patent by the prior art. Here's a big one. You make an invention, but you drafted the claims with some silly little remark. I am attaching a rubber to the end of the pencil by a brass sleeve. Why a brass sleeve? Why brass? You know, you don't want to make a mistake like that. Your attorney isn't supposed to make a mistake like that. But trust me, you'll be much better off if you understand what your attorney's doing enough to question him or her, and actually sit back yourself and say, look, I don't use brass anymore. I can use steel, I can use aluminum. So you have to use a metal sleeve. And then someone will say, well, does it have to be metal? So drafting the patent is all about thinking through the process and understanding it. And then the last possibility is really one your attorney's not responsible for. And that is, if you think of a good idea and someone else thinks of a different idea that's just as good or better, then there's going to be a loophole in your patent. So there's two kinds of fundamental loopholes. One is a drafting error where you put a limitation in your supposed monopoly. And the other one is where you neglect to think of other ways to do it. And you should understand that the patent is all about what the competitors are free to do when they want to go into competition. So your patent will end up on the table at your competitor's office, and they'll sit in a circle, and they'll read your statement of exclusive rights, the one that you wrote with your attorney, and they'll say, gee, how can we go into competition with this guy and not violate this patent? Well, you would have had to have been careful drafting the claim, and you would have had to have thought ahead as to what they might turn to. Now, your attorneys, I've had an attorney say to me, David, I'm not hired to invent. But I have a good little example of the revolving door as patented in America in the 1880s. And in my story, he gets a patent on a revolving door with four panels and another cylindrical wall, two entrances and everything. And after he gets his patent, a year later, he's walking down the street and he sees a revolving door with three panels. He rushes to his patent attorney. I want to collect money. I want to sue this guy and collect money from him. Well, the attorney pulls out the patent and says, I claim exclusive rights in four revolving door panels. Well, I'm sorry, says the attorney. You said four, he's only using three. You're not going to be able to enforce your patent. So the inventor says, how did that happen? And the attorney says, I wrote down what you told me. Now that's an apocryphal story because the actual patent did refer to three revolving doors. And I imagine that the inventor and the attorney sat down together and said, look, how many revolving panels do we have? We could have five. Well, if you had somebody who built a unit with five doors and you stipulate for at least three doors, five is at least three doors, so you've covered it. But if you stipulate there must be four doors and there's only three in the competitor's design, they're off the hook. So one of the key principles that I want to share with you is to think like a competitor and what could I do to get around this claim? Now, ironically, I have seen a revolving door with two panels. Jean-Paul's nodding his head up and down. When I saw it, I was astounded because I didn't think it could be done. Well, I'm not going to tell you how to do it because it's a bit of a challenge. It is an invention to think of a revolving door with two panels that doesn't violate the airlock principle. So part of your job is to invent the advances that might be made by others and then incorporate them into your filing. So I've given some other papers, and they'll be in the notes. This paper arising out of ICCF 17, that was the Brillouin patent in the United States. It was being rejected at the time by the US Patent Office because of their rule that you have to satisfy them that your invention works. And Brillouin didn't satisfy the US examiner, and the patent was abandoned. It was replaced with a fresh application. But that's the story from the first paper that I did in ICCF 17. And Missouri, ICCF 18, I talked about two different patents there. One on an invention by Melvin Miles. Melvin was working for the US Navy, and Melvin had come up with an alloy that did a very nice job at producing excess heat, but the crafty attorney working for the US Navy wrote it up that the alloy had other uses. And this rule about you have to show it works at the US Patent Office means you have to show one useful application. So the patent went through on the basis that this is an alloy that has these uses, and oh, by the way, you can create excess heat if you set it up in an LENR experiment. The patent's available, the claim is outstanding, it hasn't been canceled, but it doesn't produce very much excess heat, and so it's not commercially on the market. The other patent that's discussed in that paper is a patent by a fellow called Cook, James Cook. Now, he's an older man. He's living on social welfare, old age pension, I suppose, in the United States. And he heard on the radio from a psychic what was causing the Pons and Fleischmann effect. And it had to do with loose transformers in the room causing vibration and magnetic fields. So he rushed to a patent attorney. And the patent attorney said, oh yes, tell me your story, okay. You're going to have to pay money to do this. Are you sure you want to go forward? And he did. And he filed his patent at the U.S. Patent Office. And he admitted in the patent that he got the idea from a psychic on the radio. And he included the following statement. This is what his attorney wrote down. James stated in the patent, the first and second acoustic wave generators must operate at different frequencies. The specific frequencies required remain to be determined by experimentation. That's fatal. You haven't completed the invention. You haven't created a recipe for how to build it. His attorney charged him $10,000, filed these papers, and this patent application was doomed to failure. And when the patent office said, I don't believe it works, prove it works, and by the way, you've got an inadequate disclosure here, he had to abandon the application, but he's still paying the attorney $100 a month out of his old age security. So, I'm coming now to Andrea Rossi's patent. On August the 25th, 2015, Rossi got a patent through the U.S. Patent Office. And everybody was excited at the time, and a lot of criticism. There's several aspects to a patent. One aspect is it tells you the story of how to build it and make it work. And it's supposed to work. And if it doesn't work, the patent's invalid. So if Rossi's recipe doesn't work, this patent is invalid. The second thing is the patent tells you what you can't do. Well, I'm going to just go through this claim. Now, a claim is a sentence. It's actually a sentence. Why it's a sentence, I don't know. Claims were invented in the United States in 1836. Before that, people would say, I want to be the exclusive person to control what I describe in the attached story. And there's a lot of crazy litigation that was going on up until 1836 when this got cleaned up. And the United States was one of the first countries to introduce claims. So a claim is a statement of your exclusive rights. And a claim is a simple sentence which is a checkoff list. Now everybody's intimidated by claims. I'm intimidated by claims because the attorneys who write them use very vague words. They talk about a beaker, but they say a vessel. They're trying to use words that are general. However, the principle is very simple. Your exclusive rights are described in these claims. You're allowed more than one, but the first claim has to be an independent statement that doesn't refer to any other claim. It has to be one sentence, and it's a checkoff list. So when you start going through this claim, well, there's a tank, there's an electrical resistor, there's a fuel wafer, wherein the tank is configured for holding fluid to be heated. Jeez, it sounds pretty naive. Wherein the fuel wafer is configured to be in thermal communication with the fluid. This sounds like stuff that existed before. Well, it turns out that many of even all of the individual elements that are listed may have existed before, but it's the collection that has to be new. And it's the collection that you get to violate. Now, there's an electrical resistor interfitted with the fuel, and the electrical resistor is there to heat up the fuel. The fuel is nickel and lithium plus lithium aluminum hydride. So we're getting to the second half of the claim. That's all there is two halves. And it says there's a voltage source and a temperature sensor wherein said fuel mixture comprises lithium and lithium aluminum hydride, wherein the catalyst is a group 10 element of which nickel is a principal one, wherein the controller is configured to monitor the temperature and to reinvigorate a reaction in the fuel mixture. And the reinvigoration is done by turning on a voltage and applying it. That is the entire claim. So if you're a competitor, if you can remove one element, you don't infringe. So you say, well, do we have to have lithium? I don't know. Do we have to have lithium aluminum hydride? What about lithium borohydride? Somebody who knows it, not me, but sharp ears, mentioned that possibility. So if you use lithium borohydride, you don't infringe the claim. Now, there's a whole bunch of dependent claims that refer back to this first claim, wherein the group 10 metal is nickel and stuff like that. What about reinvigorating the reaction by heating it with natural gas or something instead of electricity. So this claim actually has potential loopholes. I say potential loopholes because it may be that aluminum, lithium aluminum hydride is the best. And if it's the best, it's what people want to use. And the value of the claim is the gap that separates it from the next best alternative. So the claim might have some value, but it's not a revolutionary claim. Having said that, I will finish the analysis of whether we infringe this claim. There are 9 other claims that refer back to it. And people, I've had somebody brag to me, I have 60 claims in my patent. Well, excuse me, all the claims that refer back to the first claim are redundant. If the first claim is valid and infringed, you don't need a claim that says everything in claim 1 plus nickel. So it's that independent claim that counts, and claim 1 is always independent. Occasionally there's a claim that is independent, claim 16. So there's an example of how you evaluate a claim to find out whether you infringe, but it's also a lesson in drafting the claim, because if this wasn't drafted properly, it's got a loophole. It's not worth very much money. It's a joke. So, can other people compete with you without falling within the language of the claim? And then I've talked about eliminating lithium aluminum hydride. I've talked about reinvigorating from a combustible gas. There's a case, most interestingly, occurring in Florida. It'll be go to trial this month if it isn't settled. It could settle. By the way, Rossi can't settle the case by just stopping it. There's a cross action by Industrial Heat. They've sued Rossi and said that what they got from them for their $10 or $11 million didn't work. So if Rossi cancels and says, I don't want to sue you anymore, Industrial Heat is entitled to carry through with the trial on the cross action. I don't know what would happen, because if Rossi offered to settle this for $500,000, I think Industrial Heat would accept that. So, next question. Oh, I should tell you one more thing about that action down in Florida. When it was begun, there was an accusation that Industrial Heat had violated the U.S. patent by soliciting customers in Europe. What a harebrained accusation. American patents are not violated by soliciting people in Europe. I don't understand why the attorney put that in. I think Rossi must have yelled at him and told him, I want you to do it. Anyway, they had what they call a pretrial hearing, and the judge said, I agree, this could never succeed. So there are no patents issues in this litigation in Florida. It's all about collecting money, and also maybe the accusation, Industrial Heat filed 2 U.S. patent applications naming their own engineer and Rossi as co-inventors, and Rossi said, I never gave you permission to do that. This is an issue of breach of confidentiality. It's not an issue of violating a patent. So, will there ever be a controlling patent in the field of cold fusion? Well, one thing's for sure, you can't ever get a patent on a theory or an abstract concept. Patents issue, I've worked on this. Patents issue for arrangements that are new and unobvious. An arrangement means a physical structure or a procedure for manipulating physical things. Fleischmann and Pons did obtain a patent in Europe, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. But I want to say something about this question of whether a master patent can issue. A master patent can never interfere with the prior art. And we've had 28 years since Fleischmann and Pons gave their talk in Utah. So there's a huge amount of prior art out there. And I was prepared to come to this meeting and say to you all, there will not be a master patent in the field of cold fusion. And then David Nagel drew attention to an idea that he had, which he published, and he's given me permissions, nodding his head forward here, that I'm allowed to continue. There's some talk of incredible shrinking atoms. We have Randall Mills and his black light power, now bright light power. And there's a concept called a tresino, which is a shrunken hydrogen atom that ends up with it becomes a negative ion. David suggested that if an Eliénard reaction is a two-step process, first you form a shrunken atom, then you move to a different location, and you carry out a nuclear process. And he said, you could lay down epitaxial layers. The first layer is conducive to forming the shrunken atom, and the second layer is conducive to the nuclear reaction. And I said, bingo, David, that's an invention. And it could be a pretty controlling invention. Now, it's not the theory that's involved, it's the arrangement. And it's a very pregnant with potential arrangement here. And I said to David, I said, you didn't quite complete it because you didn't show that it works. You didn't provide a structure for the first epitaxial layer, or a structure for the second epitaxial layer that had Ed Storms' active locations and everything. So this is a half-complete invention, and you're welcome to brainstorm about how to complete it, but if you were to come up with a working system that worked better, and the advantage of an epitaxial layer is you're not going to lay down two. You're going to lay down two, and then two, and then two. You're going to have 100 of them, and they're going to produce substantial heat, which is the name of the game. So my statement that you could never have a dominant patent in the field, thank you, is not quite true. Something can always come up that you don't expect. Now, few people appreciate that Fleischmann and Plantz got a European patent. And it lapsed. It was opposed by Clean Energy Technologies of Sarasota, Florida. I think that's Patterson. I'm not sure about that. Why Patterson opposed it, I don't know, but the University of Utah had turned the patent over to a private company and they didn't want to defend it. I don't know why. Maybe they knew that the formula in the patent didn't work. But if you want homework, and I really recommend that you do this, there are two independent claims of the European patent, and they were written back at the beginning before there was a lot of prior art. There was the 1926 paper by the two Austrians or Germans, and there was a Swedish paper from 1970. But there was hardly any prior art. So if there were an attempt to have a broad patent, it's in claims 1 and 16 of the European patent. And in the handout, which you'll be getting, or it's available as part of this, I have the cover of the European patent, and I have all 30 claims. And you only have to read claim 1, or claim 16, and you apply the test. Could I build a useful system that doesn't fall within this claim? So why are you trying to obtain a patent anyway? You want to profit from having a monopoly by charging high prices. Doesn't sound gracious, but that's what it's about. And that's the reason you want to charge high prices. So if you are going to get a patent, you want to do it right. You want to work closely with your attorney and understand the process. You want to close the loopholes when those critical claims are being drafted. And to do that, you have to think like your competitor. So that's my wish for you. And I can be approached for questions after. And also on Friday, there will be a workshop in which I will continue the discussion that we've had now, primarily answering questions for anybody that wants to put questions to me about patents. Michael?